the Lord eventually started to say, Amber, you are Ms. All Wrong, and he's Mr. Wrong, but that's because nobody is perfect. There is no perfect person except for Jesus Christ. And so that's what I had to come to. It was like, you know what? We made a vow. God did bring us together. We need to yield to being perfected in Christ day by day. And that's what's going to make us right for each other.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
There's a verse in Romans that catches my attention. If it's possible, the verse says, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Now, I don't know that we always think about that verse in the context of our spouses, but that would be the first place to apply it, right? Live at peace with your spouse. If that describes where you're at, maybe not at peace with your spouse, and you need to be at peace with your spouse, today's program is going to be for you, because God's mercies are new every morning. And as you listen to today's program, I'd encourage you to surrender your marriage and your heart to the Lord in this area of your life.
Mm-hmm. And Guy and Amber are some great guests. They're relationship coaches. They're TV production professionals. They've written a book called Marriage Triggers, Exchanging Spouses' Angry Reactions for Gentle Biblical Responses.
What a great deal.
It is. And we do have, of course, that book here at the ministry. Give us a call if you'd like a copy. And Jim, we should mention that your wife Jean has joined. I think that's very brave of you to invite Jean into the studio.
You took the words right out of my mouth, John. No, it's great to have Jean with us. Welcome, Jean.
Well, thank you.
And so many people, so many people love it when you're here. So thanks for saying yes. Guy and Amber, thanks for being back with us.
Thanks for having us. Absolutely.
Let's get into it. Marriage triggers. I'm sure people listening right now are thinking of all kinds of triggers that they might have. We talked about a few last time, the backseat driver. Jean and I had to navigate that a bit. We're both backseat drivers.
Yes.
And then just the expectation. I think out of last time, the thing that I captured the most was how to manage your expectations in your relationship. And Amber, you did a beautiful job describing that as a new bride and what you expected Guy to live up to, which was basically God.
Yes, exactly. Sure, of course. Unattainable.
I think all of us guys were going, whew, finally a woman said it. Yeah. I can't be that. And I so appreciate that honesty. Let's kick off today, Amber, with your love language. It's something Gary Chapman is the author of the Love Language book. He's been on Focus many times. It. He's a great friend. Mm-hmm. And you identify with words of affirmation.
Yes.
Jean, I think you would agree with that for you, right?
Sure.
Words of affirmation
Absolutely.
Is your core love language.
Right.
But you describe Guy as pretty much pathetic in that delivery mechanism of words of affirmation.
Right.
Is that fair, Guy? Did I over-dramatize it?
It's very fair.
I think, just to be honest, Jean might agree with Amber that I, too, am pathetic at delivering in that love language. Jean, do you want to affirm
that? Pathetic is so harsh, but
there's room to grow. Room to grow.
What a good HR person you are. But that room to grow. So, Amber, describe that area where, you know, this is how you communicate. That's Gary Chapman's conviction on this. Is everybody's wired with a certain communication style, things that affirm your heart.
Yeah.
Words of affirmation or what affirm your heart or what affirms Jean's heart. How did Guy let you down? And Jean, get ready. I'll come to you about how I've let you down.
Yeah, and you know, that book, Gary Chapman's ministry, was profoundly impacting on me early on in those early days of our marriage, because it gave me a concrete understanding of why some of these triggers were also taking advantage of our relationship, because we were not feeding each other in the way that we felt really truly loved. But early on, especially when I recognized that my love language was words of affirmation, Guy's is really acts of service. You know, he would just, I mean, our kitchen was sparkling. I mean, I never had to do a dish and I loved that. But he just thought he was loving me so well, because I never had to dry a dish and put it away. I mean, and he was excellent. He's still excellent at that. I still don't do dishes to this day, really. I mean, he's so good at that. But I was just starving for that affection, and I couldn't understand why he wouldn't get with the program. And so,
did you ever talk that out? I mean, did you ever sit down?
I'm pretty sure that his book was the first book that was given to me by my wife.
Yes.
As it was actually the DVD set for the driving my 45-minute commute every day.
There's a hint.
But you know, we were so triggered for so long that we couldn't even get to the point where we were doing that really well for one another, giving each other what each other needed.
What was that turning point then?
Crisis. I'd come to a day where I was in so much pain in our relationship, and I just finally, it was just a God thing, where I came to the end of my tether. And I just said, I have to either do something radically different, or tomorrow's going to look just like today. And because my efforts in trying to fix my husband and be his Holy Spirit voice were not working, I knew the only person that I could control was myself. And so I just started with, Lord, I'm not sure what to do, but I know that you know what to do. Yes. And so I'm just going to be an open book. I need you to just cleanse me and show me what to do, think, and say, because I don't know what to do, Lord. It's in your hands.
I ironically had to, it's one of those situations where you see your wife walk by you and you think to yourself, wow, she looks absolutely stunning. But it stays in me and doesn't come out of my mouth to her.
Yeah. Right, you're having a conversation in your head.
And I do that a lot. Yeah. And because for some reason, I just wasn't purposeful about getting that out and telling her what I was thinking in those moments. And that's what she needed, is she wanted to hear those things. Mm-hmm. I appreciate you. I appreciate what you did yesterday. Those kinds of things. And I just didn't verbalize it. So I found myself having to schedule in my calendar.
Yes, you did.
Twice a day, I would do a reminder in my calendar that just said, think Amber. And it would pop up. It would be a quick reminder on my BlackBerry at the time. And it would just say that. And it would be purposeful for me to call her and say something or to remember. And not that I did it all the time, but I needed a prompt to like remind myself
great.
That she needed something.
It was okay. And honestly, for me, it didn't remove the meaningfulness of it, because at least he was working towards it. But I also had to come to a point where I decided I was either going to hold him to my standard, my expectation, or I was going to choose to see him the way that he does love me. So I did a switch in my brain, you know, through a lot of prayer. Lord, help me not to be so impacted by what he's not doing, speaking words of affirmation to me, and instead really look actively for the ways that he is showing you that he loves you, Amber. And so then I was able to let go. Like it doesn't impact me so much anymore that he doesn't compliment me. And God gave me two sons that are like really words of affirmation boys. And so, you know, we give that to one another in ample measure. Mm-hmm. And so Guy's kind of off the hook a little bit, but I just choose to see every day that he serves me.
This is something we still deal
That's
with. I'll admit, just the other night, Amber has had a whiteboard that she wanted hung up in our office. And it's been sitting there for like 2 months.
Me and my house projects.
And we had a little bit of an argument. And instead of me dealing with it and apologizing to her and telling her, I hear you, I went and took care of that whiteboard. I put it up. I put it up in a room and it made sure that it was up and perfect and all great. And she didn't say anything that night. And the next day I was like, we were talking, things were a little bit better. And I was like, did you happen to see the whiteboard? You know, and it was my way of kind of, instead of verbalizing to her,
I still did
my act of service.
I did
so I still fall.
It,
I still
and I
fall
did
into
feel
that.
The love in a way but I wouldn't have
pulled
in the
her
past,
aside.
I knew.
I could have pulled her aside and had that conversation in the moment at that night.
Well,
for
and
some
what
reason, I still.
Yeah, and I've learned that, you know, if you argue over the project and then you do the project, it's only half credit.
Yeah, this is true. This is true.
You don't get an A, but you get a C. Now, Amber and Guy, you make a statement in the book where you're identifying a question that God often puts on both of your hearts during arguments and misunderstandings. Now that's really spiritually sensitive that you can hear the Lord as you're arguing. That's far better than me. I usually have to calm down and then, okay, Lord, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that. And I love what it is. Do you want to win the argument or do you want love to win? That is a beautiful starting point and one that most of us couples just blow right by.
Again, when you get to a place of brokenness and you say, God, I don't know what to do, but I need you to show me, he will show up for you. You can always count on God to be there to you. He hears our prayers. He hears the ache in your heart that you can't even put into words.
Right.
And that's where I was. And so I remember very vividly being at a point where Guy and I were in an argument. And I just remember this thought that came into my mind, Amber, do you want to win? Or do you want love to win? Because if you want to keep winning this argument, tomorrow's going to look just like today, and you're not living life to the full.
You know, Amber, mm-hmm. the thing about that, it sounds right and true, and everybody just went, whew, yeah, that would be good. But then you got to do it.
That's right.
And that's the hard part. And why, I guess two questions. One, why do we have that hesitancy? What becomes the obstacle in doing what is so right?
It's because we're not living out Colossians 3, 12 through 14. And that, at least for me, that was true, which says, you know, put on a compassionate heart with kindness, meekness, patience. And it says to bear with one another, right? Mm-hmm. Which means we're going to have to bear with each other through some of these triggers. And so what that looks like is me taking a deep breath instead of starting to na-na-na-na-na again. And literally I would stop. We've got to the practice of stopping in the middle of the wrong words,
right,
and saying, I'm upset. I recognize it. I didn't mean to really say that. And I want to not say anything further that's going to be damaging. Let's take a break for a few minutes so that we can refocus on what it is that we want in our marriage, which is we want to be for each other. Mm-hmm. We want the marriage that God designed it to be. So we need to step away for a minute. We gave each other's permission. Hey, can we stop for a minute and go take a breather until we can calm down and have a conversation outside of conflict?
Right.
And we just got good at giving ourselves permission to do that. And then that did just take spiritual maturity. But that isn't that the point, you guys? Isn't the point for us, all of our relationships, to be about being refined?
Yes.
This life is not our own. If we start thinking, well, it's just about healing the marriage, it's not just about healing the marriage. This is about an eternal reward. This is about living and becoming more like Christ. And that's our end game. So we need to start doing things differently than we've been doing. And let's be forgiving each other just like Christ forgave us. And then we've got to start saying and doing things differently.
Well, and I think you're saying exactly what I believe is the purpose of marriage. Yes. You know, and the whole culture and the me orientation that we have is, what am I getting out of this? Almost like a contract.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It is so obvious that the Lord said, listen, I'm creating this institution so you can become more like me.
That's yes.
It. That's scary because that description is selfless.
It is.
Giving, right. Kind, loving.
And learning to serve
one
another, which is not natural.
Right.
That's not natural.
It works against our flesh, but it's what the Lord wants. Mm-hmm. I think that is the whole answer to why marriage. Why did we do
it? And it might feel like, we always tell people, if it feels like the death of you to yield in that moment, then you're in the right place.
Yeah.
Because it should be the death of you. It's
exactly
the death
right.
to self.
Yes.
Mm. So if it feels like the death of you, that's the right place to be.
And it's so helpful just to pause, to give permission to pause and not try to solve the problem in the moment when the heat is going. Stepping back has been so helpful for us. And I hope as you're watching and listening along here, you're finding a lot of great handles to grab onto for your relationship. This is Focus on the Family with Jim Daly. We've got Guy and Amber Lia here with us as our guests, and Jean Daly as well. Guy and Amber have a book, Marriage Triggers, Exchanging Spouses' Angry Reactions for Gentle Biblical Responses. That's what we're talking about right here. And we want to make sure you get a copy of this book. Just give us a call, 800-A-FAMILY, or click the link on your screen.
Let me transition a little bit and go to something that really caught my attention in the book. There was a point you said in your marriage when you realized you didn't have a foundation of friendship. Hmm. Okay, I believe most married people are leaning in right now when they've heard that, because there are seasons in marriage when you don't feel close. It's busy, it's kids, it's, you know, littles running around and pulling on everybody's time. But I guess the first question is, what made you realize that I don't have a foundation of friendship with my spouse? And what did that look like?
We didn't like each other very much at one point.
Yeah, I think, you know, just like you said, you get so caught up in all of the demands and the things that are happening. You shift your focus from being a married, young married couple who are very good friends to suddenly everything shifts to care of the kids, care of parents. Care of your career, all of these other things. And the friendship slowly becomes the last thing that you get to because everything else feels important. And so we stopped dating.
Yeah.
We stopped having time for ourselves. When we would go out to parties, we always had kids with us, you know, and it just, the opportunities to continue to build our friendship became less and less and less.
Yeah.
And so we had to decide that in order for everything else to flourish, we have to redevelop our friendship. and find ways to build that again. And it just has fed into all of the other areas of our lives.
What have you found to be the best way to do that? I mean, what comes to my mind is spending time together. Mm-hmm. It's kind of simple, but yeah. When you got married for a reason, you mm-hmm. were attracted to each other, you loved each other, you said yeah. yes, mm-hmm. and then you get busy with the distractions you identified. But the best remedy for not feeling that friendship is rekindle the friendship, spend time together, do things together. Is that fair?
Yes, absolutely. We are firm believers that you have to set aside time. And it yeah. doesn't have to be a big weekend away or mm-hmm. a big crazy steak dinner. It can be coffee. It
right.
can be an yes. hour.
Time together.
It yes. can be an hour at Starbucks just to say, how are you? And have a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Right. And it's amazing what that hour can do every week.
Yeah. Let me ask you this for the wife. Just picture someone in your mind, a wife or husband, who's saying, I hear what you guys are talking about, but I don't feel like my spouse wants friendship yeah. with me. What recommendation do you have to that yes. desert feeling that yeah. I'm not getting any response and maybe
That's
they're
important.
Using the mm-hmm. wrong tactics that might right? be, but what yeah. what would you say that individual says, yeah. I'm in trouble?
Well, when you get to the point where you don't really like each other because the friendship has faded, mm-hmm. it's difficult to have the emotional energy to want to even be together in those kinds of moments. So Guy and I early on in one of those early conversations we had was, we need to simply fake it till we make it for a little bit, because we know that putting in place some time for one another and to do things that we used to do that we no longer do that were fun for us together, we have to start putting those things back in place and trust the process that we are going to rekindle those emotions and feelings of friendship at some point.
And it's really important. I want to punch mm-hmm. that a little bit, because what you're saying is go through the motions when you don't
yes.
feel it,
yes.
because your feelings will catch up with the right actions.
That's right. Because
it's not lying, or it's just doing the right thing.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah. we do a lot of parenting ministry, and one of the things I tell moms and dads, like, if you're having a rough day, just stop and smile. Just start smiling. You know, if the kids are getting to you, whatever, it, just stop and smile. Just the act of yeah. smiling, it scientifically, you can read the research
right.
reports, but it has an impact on your thinking, on your mindset. And it's the same. Like, even if it's something new that you're trying together, you know, find
yeah.
some common ground that you both is new territory for
yeah.
both of you even.
Right.
But make that time, be purposeful, be intentional. And Guy and I also got really structured in our calendar. You know, mm-hmm. if you feel like life has a chokehold on you, your schedule has a chokehold on you, then you have to remove that chokehold in very purposeful ways. We're intentional to plan downtime in our calendar, where we have time where it's mm-hmm. just nothing is planned, and we don't let anything encroach on that, so we can just relax at home even and not have something to do all the time.
That's important.
But also, you know, we color code our calendar. You know, here's things for the kids, here's things for homeschool, here's things for work.
Wow,
but
that is organized.
I know.
That's
the planning thing. That's me.
And we run three businesses. We homeschool.
Yeah.
We do everything together. So we're not talking about like I work and she's at home. We both have crazy, crazy schedules like a lot
yeah.
of you guys
nowadays
do. It's a challenge.
Yeah, and I hear that. And that applies then. If you guys can do it, others can do it.
Yeah.
That's
true.
The point.
Yes, true.
Let me go to the spiritual side of this in the last few minutes that we have here. This is one of the big triggers. And we hear from couples, a lot of wives, to disclaim that. Mm-hmm. But they feel like their husbands aren't leading. They're not taking that spiritual leadership role.
Yes.
And it's frustrating.
Very
and
hard.
The wife is, you know, it's hard to not have some expectations.
It is. Yes.
And so I guess that would be the question. Mm-hmm. What do you say to that spouse who is struggling with, that wife who's struggling with the lack of her husband doing what he should be doing to be the spiritual
yeah.
leader of the home?
Yeah, that lack of spiritual leadership issue is one that I had no idea was so common
yes.
until I started being transparent about that in our own marriage.
Then you found out just about everybody struggles
with
this.
A lot of people struggle with that.
Yes.
Right.
And so I got really caught up in what my kind of growing up mindset of what a spiritual leader would look like, and then really was putting that on Guy. And, you know, Guy is on his own spiritual path,
mm-hmm.
and so am I. And so we had to allow room for one another to be who we are in Christ
mm-hmm.
and for the Holy Spirit to work on us. So it didn't mean that we couldn't have conversations about that, but we're supposed to spur one another on toward love and good deeds. it didn't say nag him to death because he doesn't mm-hmm. lead a Bible study over dinner every night. You know, this expectation that I had that he was going to come in, spiritual leadership looks like him picking the Bible verse for the month that our kids are going to memorize, and he's going to come up with a cool song so they memorize it, because that was what I like to do. That was my strength. And so I just put that on Guy. That's like, right. Why aren't you doing this? And so I became very judgmental of him, mm-hmm. and that's not a good place to be in a marriage.
Well, and I entered our relationship feeling this way because Amber, we both have grown up in Christian homes, but Amber, you know, literally studied, you know.
She took it seriously.
Yeah, took it very seriously.
I went to Bible college. I have a minor in theology.
We just had very different experiences. And so my faith, mm-hmm. I think, tends to come out a little bit more in when I'm with the kids hiking and I can make things very real to them spiritually, or when I can have conversations with them on a one-to-one basis. I may not sit down and have the family Bible study, but I pour into them in the way that I can connect with them. And it's a very different way.
Did you feel that pressure coming from Amber?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Well, without
expectation.
A doubt.
My bad.
But I never felt like I could ever do that because I always felt like she would criticize me, or I can never do the right thing, or I'm going to do the wrong verse. I literally went into it like
this
that.
May be the 80-20 rule. I think 80-90% of us husbands feel this. Mm-hmm. I know for Jean and I, that was it. She did, I think, speak to this, but being a biology major, mm-hmm. I mean, she wanted a very traditional devotion with the family after dinner. Yeah. And I'm like, we have two boys. Yeah. If we had daughters, that might work.
Maybe.
Mm-hmm. But two boys, we got to go out in the backyard, roll around. And then when they hurt me, I'm going to say, you remember King Saul?
That
really was my approach mm-hmm. to integrating faith mm-hmm. into everyday life. Yeah, and I think that is typical of husbands, where we're looking for, like, driving them to school. We talk about Proverbs. Yeah. I'd have them read a proverb as I was taking them to school.
Right.
But Jean wasn't seeing that.
Yes.
And I think, you know, it gave her the sense that I never talk about the Lord with the boys. And that wasn't accurate.
And it is judgmental. Mm-hmm. Amber, you use that. It is
better
judgmental.
You say that than me.
It is. That absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that to think that we have it all right. That we know exactly how it should be done, sitting down with that devotion.
But let me come to your rescue for a minute, because one of the things I've noticed with moms particularly, there is a fear and control component. We're in a very difficult culture where the culture is grabbing our kids and telling them, you know, mm-hmm. about sex and about other things, and it scares us.
Yes, that's right.
And I think moms particularly really deeply feel that threat. And so they want an antidote. They want, if they're going to give our children this, we got to give them that. And that's absolutely true. And so I think it's born out of a good place to compensate for the messaging that kids are receiving in the culture.
It is. Our hearts are in the right place.
Yeah, and we just have to figure out how we do that effectively, because if you're wagging your finger at your kids, that's not going to work.
And it's really about letting each person's spiritual strengths be their spiritual strengths. You know, we have different personalities, and because we're on different spiritual levels of maturity, just naturally you're two different people, it was really important for me to come to a place where I didn't have to live in fear that my kids were going to be sucked into culture or other influences. And if I had continued to place my expectation of what spiritual leadership should look like on him, we would all be missing out.
No, and I so appreciate that. And that's a good word for, again, I think moms particularly who do have those concerns. I mean, husbands aren't off the hook. Don't get that message here. We've got to be engaged. We need to be engaged. You need to be dad. And talk about the Lord in those contexts that fit you and amplify the Lord's work in your own life.
Right.
We are right near the end, Amber and Guy, and we've taken a mostly lighthearted approach to these things, but there's been depth to what we've talked about. I always say, you know, it's hard to cover all the content in this great book. People just need to get the book, and they can read it and highlight it and underline it. But there was a night, and I want to make sure we capture this, there was a night when your fighting got so bad, and some couples are going to identify with this because they're there right now. But you, Amber, considered leaving your marriage. What happened that night, and what helped you to turn the corner, the two of you?
Well, I recognized that I would give up every personal happiness for the sake of my kids. Like, I would have stayed in my marriage unhappy just to try to give my kids some semblance of security. But that wasn't really working, because I remember very distinctly the Lord speaking to my heart and saying, I am not creating you to settle for less than God's best, for less than my best for you. I did not design or bring you together to just navigate through life and soldier through and try to keep peace that's a false peace by just not arguing anymore. I came to give life to the full, you know, Jesus says. And so I recognized that I could not at that point allow Satan to win and to fracture us and to overtake us by our triggers. And so I just came to the point of great humility of saying, Lord, and it was totally the Lord, because when you're at that point and you just think that it's hopeless, it's a very dark place to be. But because we had children, and I think a lot of couples feel this way, they want to keep that marriage intact. Absolutely. And so I just made a decision. And actually, I remembered our wedding vows. Guy and I said on the day that we got married, and people kind of guffawed at the thought of what we were saying, but we said out loud to each other, I will not divorce you. And so we'd said that because we knew that there would be challenges. Yes. And we wanted to hear it. And really, the fact that we had said that, and I think a lot of couples obviously are that's the intention when you get married, is that you'll till death do us part. But we wanted to say it out loud so that when those nights come, like the one where I wanted to just go, we would remember what we said and continue to fight for one another.
Yeah.
As opposed to with each other. Because if we're so busy fighting each other, we are powerless to fight the good fight, to fight the better fight. And that's what I realized. I realized that if I walked away today, I will not be fighting the good fight anymore with him. And God can make a way. If he is the God of yesterday, today, and forever, and he is unchanging, then there's nothing that's impossible with him. And he can bring us back together again. And he has. When you come to that point, we really are prayerful that you will consider that your triggers are not the end of your story, and that there is an opportunity for hope and for growth. And we're living proof of that.
Yeah.
Really.
Guy, your perspective on that.
Yeah, I just totally agree. Amber made a comment one time about there is nothing that anger can do that love cannot do better. And for me, that really has settled, you know, for me in those moments when I'm feeling anger, it just pops into my mind. And I just remember this is not what the Lord has in store for me. And I control the ship, and I have to make a decision right here to love her better, even if it's not what I want in this moment, because I know that that's what's best.
And you alluded to that scripture, and it was the first scripture that I was given as a new Christian at 15, John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you might have life and life more abundantly. And that's in every area. That's what's amazing about that scripture. It's about your marriage. It's about your relationships. The enemy of our soul is on the prowl. And he wants to take down your relationship, especially if you're a Christian.
That's right.
Because it credits him in so many different ways. And that's why we need to be on guard. This has been great. Let me say to the listener, there's a couple of things that FOTF has for you. One is a free marriage assessment tool. We've had over 1 million people take this, and it just points out what you're doing well and what you can work on. And I think what Amber and Guy have talked about the last couple of days would be a critical area of work for you if your marriage isn't where it needs to be right now. Know what your triggers are, what your spouse's triggers are. There's also for that couple who's really struggling. This isn't the tune-up situation. That couple that is thinking of divorce, let me encourage you to contact us about our Hope Restored Marriage Intensive Program. I said last time it has an 81% post 2 year success rate, meaning we go back to those couples 2 years later, 81% of them are doing better and are still married. And it's an incredible 4-day experience. That's the typical intensive. And I think if you're in that spot, call us, because you need that kind of help to communicate better with your spouse. Most importantly, get the book, Marriage Triggers. I said last time, We'll send it to you. Just let us know if you can support the Ministry of Focus on the Family with a monthly gift, a one-time gift. We'll send it as our way of saying thank you. If you can't afford it, we'll send it to you. We believe in the cause of marriage and what it means to the kingdom to have a healthy, good, thriving marriage. And we'll do that for you if you just contact us.
Yeah, our heart is to help you wherever you're at, either early on in your relationship or down the road, doing okay or struggling. Let us know how we can be of service to you. Our number is 800, the letter A in the word family, 800-232-6459, or click the link on your screen and we'll be happy to help.
Guy and Amber, thank you so much for being with us. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having us. It's always a joy.
Jean, it's great to have you in here. I always enjoy having you here.
Well, thank you for having me. I love being here.
And on behalf of Jim and the team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.